from the Cooperative Extension, your friendly registered dietitian. And today we are going to talk about whole grains. All right? And so whole grains is a member of the grain group, and whole grains are the healthier version of a grain because a whole grain has all three parts of the plant as it was intended, right? On a grain, if you imagine a picture of a little grain, we have the outer covering, which is a bran, right? And inside we have what's called as the endosperm, and that's where all the energy and carbohydrates is. Yeah. And then there's a little thing called the germ in there where all your B vitamins and oils are. So all that together is a whole grain. Now, when we make flour, what we do is we strip the bran off of that grain. We take the bran off. And in doing so, the germ, which has all the healthy nutrients, gets stripped away too. So all you're left with is what?
Sugar.
Starch. The starchy endosperm. The stuff with the carbohydrates. The white part with all the energy in it. And that is what they make flour and other pasta products and other things, right? That is the refined carbohydrate. So then what they have to do is add the vitamins back into it, and that's what you call enriched flour. So whenever you look at a label and you're looking at the ingredients of this country white bread, you'll look and the first ingredient typically is going to be unbleached enriched wheat flour. Is this a whole wheat product or not a whole wheat product?
An artificially made whole wheat product.
Well,
it's not a whole grain.
I'll tell you that.
Okay, how many say whole grain? Okay, you guys are all correct because it is not a whole grain. This is enriched wheat flour, all right? So it was a wheat, right, kernel, and then they stripped the bran off. By doing so, they removed the vitamins. All they left was the starchy endosperm, and that's what they made it out of. But then they added the B vitamins back, and that's why it's enriched. So if you look on the label, it says enriched wheat flour. That is what happened here.
But not exactly the same.
Yeah, and the bran typically contains the fiber in it, and the fiber is something that's really good for your body. So if you look at the ingredients here, you'll look at dietary fiber. It says less than 1 gram in one slice of bread. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a little test while we do the rest of the cooking. And we're going to take a piece of white bread, and we're going to stick it in this bowl right here. All right. You're like, what's going on? Well, we're going to pretend that that piece of bread is in your stomach, okay?
And you're gonna ask it.
Now, I have this brown bread. Now, just because it's brown, does it mean it's healthy?
No.
Or that it's whole wheat?
No.
Not necessarily, right? We wanna make sure that we look at the label. And if we look at the label, sometimes there's clues. There might be a stamp on it, Yeah, let's see. The first item on the ingredient says whole wheat flour. So do you think this is a whole grain product?
Yes.
Yes, actually it is.
Yeah.
Whole wheat is a word you can look for, or 100% whole.
Yes.
So those type of words you want to look for. And then when you look at the amount of fiber in one slice, 5 grams of fiber. Most Americans need at least 28 grams, adults. So this helps you get on your way. Men need a little more than that, by the way. So,
but the whole, when they say that, that's what sells it.
Yeah, that's right. So here we have this. And now that's in the other stomach. Okay. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add some acid to it. We're going to pretend it's stomach acid. And we'll let it sit there and do our demonstration. And then we'll come back to it, check on it, and see how it's doing. So I have some orange juice to simulate stomach acid. Corey, would you pour enough to cup, like maybe a cup in each, just to cover the, our experiment? Because we're gonna see how it does. We're gonna see how this stuff does, and we'll let it sit there, and then we'll carry on with the rest of our stuff. Super. All right. So these are just going to sit here. You can see we've got the breads and the stomach acid. And we're going to see what happens to them after a few minutes. All right. So while that's going, what I really want to drive home today is choose whole grains as often as you can. The USDA and the Department of Health and Human Services in the Dietary Guidelines for Americans recommends that we eat at least half of our whole grain, or half, at least half of our grains from whole grains, which is about 3 servings a day. Doesn't mean 3 more servings on top of all the other servings of grains. It means substitute, yes, and use whole grains whenever possible. So I'm going to show you a few examples of whole grains, but we're also going to cook with a whole grain. And we are going to start with this wonderful grain known as barley, which is a whole grain. And so this happens to be a little bit different looking than what you're probably used to. You guys have probably seen the pearl barley that's sold in a plastic bag, right? And it takes a little bit longer to cook when you cook it, but it's still wonderful. This has been pre-cooked, so it cooks very quickly. This cooks in 10 to 12 minutes, so it's super quick. But one of the nice things about barley is that you can cook it ahead and either freeze it in a little baggie. You can freeze it in like 1 or 2 cups after you cook it and put it in the freezer, and then when you need it, you can pull it out. Or you could cook it ahead, and this even says you could cook it 2 days ahead and just keep it in the fridge until you need it. So if Sunday is your prep day for cooking, it'll be all ready. And I pretended that I already prepped for the week, so most of my stuff is already cut up and ready to go, because I thought I was gonna do this on an electric skillet in front of you guys, so we're doing it over here today. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna make something known as barley jambalaya. And the things that we're gonna start with is cooked barley. And I took 1 cup of this quick cooking barley, and I cooked it in 2 cups of water, and I put a couple of bay leaves in the water to give it flavor. Anytime you're using water in a grain, you don't have to just use water. You can add some herbs to make that water nice. You can also use juice instead of water, or substitute a little bit of juice instead of water. You could put tea bags in the water to give it a different flavor. You can do all kinds of things. So don't be afraid to experiment. You can use broth as well. I have a vegetable broth here, so that's something that you could do. So I cooked it in 2 cups of water, and I got 3 cups of barley when we were done. And I went ahead and just refrigerated it right away so that it would be ready to go today. And so we're gonna start with that. And then we also need, for this barley jambalaya, we're gonna use 3 onions that were about medium sized. I diced 3 medium onions. I diced a bell pepper. I diced or minced 2 garlic cloves. And then I diced 2 celery stalks. So far that's what's in there. And when I made this for the family, they really liked it. But I said, you know what? It would be so delicious with some okra and some shrimp. That's the only thing that was missing.
Make it jump.
Exactly. So those 2 things are things you can add in to the basic recipe. But this is a basic, easy recipe, so it didn't have those 2 yummy things in it. So we're going to go ahead and get started. We're going to heat up our pan. And let's see, I got my pan here. We're going to heat it up, and then we're going to add the oil to it. And I haven't used the stove before, so it might be fun. Yeah, so while we're heating up the pan, and then I'll add the oil and these veggies, I want to see if there's a volunteer that would like to kind of just monitor the vegetables, stir them up. Good, okay, come on. Why don't you go ahead and wash your hands? And then we'll get you going. All right, so you know, you're going to add your veggies. You're going to cook them about 5 minutes. I found that in the electric skillet, I needed to cook them about 10 to get them just to the right texture that I wanted. They may cook quicker here. And then after that, we're going to add ground turkey. But I thought very good. And we're going to add a teaspoon of oil. And we're using canola oil because it withstands high heat pretty nicely. So we're going to go ahead and do that. And why in the world do I measure it? Well, because oil goes a long way. So we just want to make sure that we watch how much oil. Actually, it is a tablespoon of oil. What am I saying? We got a lot of vegetables to put in there. All right.
So what do I need to do?
So we're heating up our oil, and that pan is nice and hot because the oil, right when I put it in, did that wavy look. Do you know what I'm talking about? So it's probably nice and ready. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna put these veggies in there, and we're gonna stir them around, all right? So I'm gonna go ahead and start. I'll just pour them in for you.
Thanks.
Whenever you're putting vegetables or anything in some hot oil, you should try to put it away from you so the oil sparkles that way instead of gets you, okay?
Very nice of you.
Once you have it going, then it's okay to turn it towards you a little bit. All right. So come on over. You're just going to gently stir that around. And we're going to get that going. You want to get it to where it looks slightly translucent, the onions, so that it just looks good. You just don't want it to stick. Just gently stir it around every once in a while.
Okay.
All right, thank you. So while he's got that going, I just wanted to talk a little bit about whole grains and why should we have whole grains, right? You guys have heard they're healthy, right?
Yeah.
Well, there's a few studies out there that the Whole Grains Council has done, or that they compiled in their research. I shouldn't say they did them, but they compiled them. And they have proof that whole grains help to reduce the risk of heart disease. So by about 25 to 36%, that's a big drop in heart disease. It helps reduce the risk of diabetes, type 2 diabetes. That's right.
What do I put the spoon? Or you just keep stirring?
Yeah, just keep stirring. And actually, let me put... No, that's good. You could rest the spoon in there when you're, like, resting it, if you want. Okay?
Okay.
All right. And then it decreases the risk of digestive cancers. And that is primarily because of the fiber that you find in whole grains, because it helps move that stuff along. And then it decreases the risk of stroke as well. So these are really nice benefits, right?
Yes.
And the nicer thing is that you can find whole grains in just about any form in so many good foods, and they really make delicious, delicious dinners. So some of the other benefits that you'll get from whole grains is that it helps you control weight, because whole grains help fill you up a little bit more than just refined. When you think about white bread versus whole grain bread, one of them has a little bit more substance to it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to fill you up a little bit more. It helps curb colon cancer. That's a big one in my family because my grandfather died from colon cancer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, colon cancer hits about people in our age group right now, like in the 50s. So it's really good, first of all, to get checked out and to have a healthy diet with plenty of whole grains in them. Again, it helps to reduce the risk of diabetes, heart disease, helps keep blood pressure in check. And so these are all wonderful things, and they're doing a lot more research. So these are just the tip of the iceberg. So whole grains are a good thing for you to have.
Could you put it in a vitamin form or something?
Well, you know, they have tried to put like fiber. You can have fiber supplements, which usually is in the form of like dust or like powder that you mix into products like
right.
drinks or whatever. That's one way, but the best way always is to get it from food first. So anytime you can, you know, get your nutrients from food, you're gonna do much better.
Right.
Yeah, so. All right, so we've got, oh, that's starting to smell really good. Let's see.
Right.
Yeah.
Go, Nathan. Go, Nathan.
That's right. It's looking very nice. And what we're gonna do next with the jambalaya is that we're gonna add ground turkey. And again, I wanted to get a little bit more flavor than what just plain old ground turkey would do. So I got turkey sausage. And you might be going, wow, that's just a piddly little amount. This is 4 ounces.
Mm-hmm.
You're right, it is a piddly amount, right? But we're just flavoring it. So we don't need a whole lot. We're just gonna flavor it. And you know, if you're looking for more of a vegetarian option and you don't want to use ground turkey, you can use something like black beans. And as a matter of fact, we're going to use black beans as well. So we're going to go ahead and put this in, and he's going to crumble it up and cook it as well. So for this one, you want to kind of crumble it up into little pieces and cook it up. So
it's kind of a tiny amount.
Yeah, it is a tiny amount, but it's going to go a long way because I made this already, so I know. So I'm going to drain these beans. And these beans are actually no salt added beans. And they cost the same amount as the ones with salt in them and as the seasoned one. I have a colander right here. And one way that you can cut the salt if you don't have no sodium in your stores is you can rinse these afterwards with cold water, and it will decrease the sodium by at least a third, if not more. So that's a really good benefit. So we're going to go ahead and let this, I actually like to rinse these because that way it looks cleaner in your food, in your item. So I'm going to let that drain a little bit, and then we're going to add it to the jambalaya. So I'm adding double protein today, but that's because I thought, you know, just 4 ounces of ground turkey, I think we need a little bit more. So we're adding a can of unsalted beans to that as well. How's that looking there, Nate?
I'm trying to get chopped.
Oh, thank you. It's a father-son effort. I love it. All right, awesome. So while that's going, we're going to get our tomatoes going as well. They have no sodium tomatoes, so you can do this. I love canned tomatoes because they're so already cut up. I don't have to cut them. And they're so convenient. And they're in season in the winter, in the summer, in the spring, and in the fall. So when you don't have access to fresh tomatoes, those type of tomatoes, canned tomatoes, are great. So I love them. And like I said, these are no sodium added, so that's a nice benefit. Now this one I got, if you're supposed to use 2 cans of regular, you know, no sodium added tomatoes, I went ahead and got 1 can of something that's like Rotel, because I like that little bit of, you know,
kick.
Yeah, so bring that a little kick to it. I actually, is anybody here really sensitive to hot food or spicy? Okay, because it does get a little bit of a kick.
Oh,
there's going to be a little bit of
Not too much, right?
Mildish. Now, if you don't have a woman out the soda, can you rinse the tomatoes off too?
Well, you probably could, but we want the juices of the tomatoes. Okay, so if you don't want the sodium and you can't find the no sodium, but there is fresh tomatoes like Roma's on sale or something, grab the Roma's and cut them up yourself. It'll be just fine. Just as long as it equals about 2 cups of tomatoes. That's what's down in a can. Although this recipe uses 2 cans, so you would want 4 cups of tomatoes. So, all right, how's that looking over there? All right, we're gonna add the beans to that. These are black beans. You can use pinos if you want. Yeah, pinot beans are good. And of course, we can always save money cooking our beans at home. But all right, so once we've got the ground turkey and the beans in there, and we've cooked them a little bit, how's that looking? All right, and if it's getting too hot, we can turn it down if you want. Yeah, there you go.
I got one thing right. It was definitely getting a little bit hot.
All right, if you want, go ahead and grab that and pour it in there. He's going to pour the tomatoes with their juices into the pan. So we're going to go ahead and pour the tomatoes and their juices, and we're going to bring it up to a simmer. So we want, a simmer is different from a boil. Why? Which one is hotter?
The boil.
Yeah, and the boil's going to be bubbling big time, right? Simmer's just a little nice gentle bubble. So did you hear that about the simmer and the boil?
Boils are hotter?
Boil is hotter, got the big bubbles bursting on the surface. Mm-hmm. Simmer is when you turn down the heat a little, it's still bubbling, but just little tiny bubbles.
Yeah, I know what simmer is. It's like a slow cook.
That's good. So put that one in there too. All right. He's answering perfectly, I tell you. Wonderful. Now, once he gets that to a simmer, we're going to add spices. This is where we add the flavor. Okay, so for the spices, we're going to add, we're going to put oregano, cayenne, salt, and lots of pepper. So you might be saying, well, why are we adding salt? Everything was no sodium.
That's why we're adding salt.
That's why we're adding salt, because everything's no sodium, but we're adding enough just to so not, you know. Yeah, but if the point is that you can control the amount of salt that goes into it. So this calls for 1 teaspoon of salt, but it's split up into 6 servings. So you might say, well, that's just too much for me. I'd rather start with less. That's fine. You can adjust salt however you want. I know I made it with 1 teaspoon yesterday and it tasted pretty good. I actually added a little more salt afterwards because I'm a very salty palate, which is bad, but my family thought it was just right. So I'm gonna let Nate go ahead and grab a teaspoon. And my oil is dripping a little bit off of that. So. Okay, so I've got my teaspoon right here. So Nate, if you would measure 1 teaspoon and add it to that. And then we're going to add also 1/2 teaspoon of ground cayenne. I would say just add the rest, right? I don't even know if that's 1/2 teaspoon, so. We'll have them just add the rest. I used chipotle yesterday because that's all I had at home. All right. And then we're going to add, all right, and then add 1/2 teaspoon of cayenne. And you could just add the whole thing because I'm pretty sure that's less than 1/2 teaspoon in there. So, all right. And we're going to add 1 1/2 teaspoons of dried oregano. So 1 1/2 of dried oregano. Here, let me help you with this one. Thanks. Woo. And 1/2.
I think that was the extra.
By the way, if you're wondering if spices will work with your food, smell it. And if you like the smell and you think it'll go good in that food, that's what helps. Smell that.
I love the smell of oregano.
Yes, good. And oregano could grow easily in your guys' garden, right? Is anybody growing oregano in your garden? Okay, but it is something that could grow easily.
Yeah.
So. And, oh, and then pepper. We're going to put 1 teaspoon. Here you go. 1 teaspoon of pepper. Oh, that smells
so good. I love that smell.
I know. I love the smell of pepper, too. So it's delish. All right. So after they add the spices, stir it up to combine it, we're going to go ahead and let it simmer. We're supposed to cover it. And I don't think we have a cover for this pan. So what I'm going to do is improvise. All right. Good? Is it simmering?
It's simmering.
All right. So what we're going to do is cover it and cook it for 15 minutes. Let those flavors develop. Now, while that's cooking, we're going to talk a little more about whole grains. It's like going back to our sponsor, which is whole grains. All right, so we're going to, how about we make some popcorn? Yeah. Did you know that popcorn is a whole grain?
Yes.
Yeah, good.
Because it's basically a whole grain of corn.
That's right. And so I've got some popcorn, and I've got my handy-dandy microwave popper that you do not need to add oil to, which is really nice. Yeah. And so we're going to.